Welcome, Dr. Saurabh, once again. Thank you so much for accepting the invitation in very short time. So students, Dr. Saurabh is there for today's session on green synthesis of nanoparticle, who is Chief Scientific Officer at Bidcare Innovations Private Limited, Pune. So welcome you, sir, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mega, for the introduction. So today we would be talking about green synthesis of nanoparticles. Now, before we dig down deep into the topic, let's first understand what nanoparticles are and what is all the fuss about that and its properties. So now, what are nanoparticles? You will come across various definitions, like nanoparticles are structured with at least one dimension that is less than 100 nanometers. The term, this comes from a Greek word, which means nanos. Now, nanos, what it means is dwarf or extremely small. So that is what nanos is. So the term nano comes from there. Now, nano is basically 1 billionth part of a unit, like nanometer or nanosecond, which is 10^9 part of a meter, which is nanometer, or 1/9th part of a second, which is nanosecond. Now, to understand better the nanoscale, let's see a comparison between the macro, micro, and nanoscale. So if you can see here in this figure at the bottom, so for macro, an average person height, that is this one, an average person height is around 180 centimeter, which is like 2 billion nanometer. Right, an apple, which is a size of 8 centimeter, is around 8 million nanometers, whereas an ant, which is approximately 5 centimeter in size, that is actually 5 million nanometers. Now, coming to microscale, thickness of an average human hair is around 80,000 nanometer, while what we can see with our eyes is a maximum size of around 10,000 nanometers. E. coli bacteria is in the range of around 2000 nanometers. Now, if we see the nanoscale, when compared to a microscale or a macroscale, the diameter of a DNA is around 2 nanometer only, whereas cellulose fibril, nanofibril, which is present in plant, is around 3.5 to around 100 nanometers only. The size of a hydrogen atom is around 0.1 nanometer. So now you can correlate how small a nanometer is. Now, a few examples of nanoparticles may include sphere-like particles like buckyball, as you can see here on the right of your screen. So buckyballs or gold nanoparticle, silver nanoparticle. They also have rod-like particles like silicon or nickel nanowire, or tube-like particles such as carbon nanotube or titanium dioxide nanotubes, which are here in the bottom right corner. Now, let's see a little bit of history so that we can correlate better. So, now, if you see the history of nanoparticles, it's not something that that came out of the blues. It was in the modern world. It was the knowledge of these substances are evident from historical things like the color glass work that you see in old churches, or for example, the Lycurgus cup, which is from the 4th century. It is made up of Roman glass. So what happens is when light is shined upon it, then you see it in green color, whereas when the light is transmitted from it, so basically when the light source is inside it or coming from behind it, then you will see a red color. Also, in pottery work of Deruta, Italy, glazes contain gold, silver, or copper nanoparticles. Only thing that you can say is that that time what people didn't know was the phenomena as to why this used to happen. So size is a material property. What do you mean by that? On the left, we see a gold bar that we are familiar with. We know it is a yellow colored, shiny, and has some luster. We know its density and kind of electrical conductivity. It is highly conductive. So these are all things that we know about gold in its bulk form. So bulk block of gold, these are the property that we already know. And in the bulk form, the material property do not change with size. So even if you cut this block into half or into 4 times or 6 times or 10 times, the property will not change. That is, the mechanical properties that are resistivity or conductivity or melting point or the optical absorption doesn't change when you reduce this bulk gold bar into smaller piece. Now on the right, we see the gold that we are discovering. We see a bunch of vials with different colored solutions in them. Now within the vials is mostly water and a dispersion of gold nanoparticles and as different sizes or different diameter of gold nanoparticle. So basically when you have a different size or a different shape or a different amount of nanoparticle, it will show different colors depending upon the optical properties. So by the way, it's not only the optical properties that are changed here, but also the material property, which means the resistivity and the conductivity and the melting properties are also changed in these small nanoparticles, depending upon the shape of the nanoparticle or size of the nanoparticle, or the amount of the nanoparticle. More the properties will come in later slide. So we'll discuss in detail about it. So why, first of all, we have these unique properties of nanoparticle? Well, they have a large surface to volume ratio. There is a very high percentage of atom or molecule on the surface. And it turns out that the surface forces are very important. While in the bulk material, the bulk forces are very dominant. Whereas in the nanoparticle, the bulk forces are not that important. Then, so basically this is true for any very small material. As the size decreases, the surface to volume ratio increases dramatically. More about this thing, this is a very important property. So I will take this property later in the slide and explain it in detail. Metal nanoparticles have in fact a unique light scattering property, and it also exhibits something called plasmon resonance. So this is what was going on the previous slide, where we discussed the example of different amount of nanoparticle in different vials. So the different colors that we saw of the same material. Now, semiconductor nanoparticles may exhibit confined energy state in their electronic band structure. They would also show different absorption properties due to different reasons other than optical property, and that is because of the confined energy states. Nanoparticles have unique physical and chemical properties beyond what we just discussed, and it is interesting that nanoparticles are in same size regime as biological structure. So this becomes very important when we think of how they may interact with our own body and other biological structures. Say for example, if you want to deliver a drug, so what you do is you tag the drug with the nanoparticle, and since the nanoparticle is extremely small, you can target it anywhere inside the body and your drug will be transported to that part to do its function. Whereas, I will give you a very, very layman example. So when you eat Disprin, say for example, you have a headache and you eat Disprin. So headache you have in your head, but what happens to that Dispril? It goes into your whole body. It goes into your leg. It goes into your hands. It also goes into your head. So what you required was it should have gone only to the head, but it goes everywhere in the body. So that's why when you have to deliver certain kinds of drug, you use nano carriers such as nanoparticles, and you tag the drug with them and send it wherever you want it to be delivered. Okay, so here is some examples of unusual property of nanoparticle. So they have lower phase transition temperatures. They have increased mechanical strength. They have unique optical properties that have altered electrical conductivity and mechanical properties. And they are able to undergo self-purification and self-perfection. So kind of by seeking certain energy states, it kind of tends towards symmetry. And this gives the nanoparticle stability to sustain in the environment in which it is kept. Now, the physical property of nanoparticles are basically dependent upon the size that we already saw, but also the shape, whether they are sphere or rod or platelets, etc. They can have an effect on their large scale properties. Now, their composition, their crystal lattice, for example, if they are face centered or body centered cubic, etc., then surface ligands or capping agents can also play a very important role on how the nanoparticles can interact with the adjacent environment and hence their physical property. Now, the medium in which these nanoparticles are dispersed, that also has a very crucial effect on the nanoparticle properties. Now, as I said earlier, the surface areas to volume is a property of nanoparticle that is very crucial. So that's why I will take this property in quite detail. So nanoparticle exhibit unique property due to their high surface area to volume ratio. Now let's see what this really means to us. Let's have a spherical particle of diameter 100 nanometer, and let's calculate its volume and area with the standard formula. The formula for volume is 4 by 3 pi r cube, and the surface area would be 4 pi r square. So let's plug in the values, and we see that the volume would be around 5.24 into 10 to the power minus 22 meter cube, whereas the area, the surface area, would be around 3.14 into 10 to the power minus 14 meter square. So surface to volume ratio that we'll have will have a difference of around 10 to the power 8. So the ratio will be greater than a million. Right now, surface area to volume. Why this is so important? Because it gives us an approximate surface area to volume ratio of greater than 10 to the power 7 is to 1. And we just found something like 10 to the power 8 in our last example, which is significantly larger, or rather much larger when we compare it with a macro size particle. So hence there is a larger surface area that is available for any kind of reaction and compared to the volume. And in bulk material, the surface area that we have is less because the particles that are more towards the inside does not count. So as the surface area to volume ratio increases, so does the percentage of atoms that are interacting with the surface. increases. So the surface forces become more dominant. This makes more sense when you think about a sphere made up of a billion atom. So this will be a bulk material as it is made up of a billion atom. So there will only be a bunch of nanoparticles or a bunch of atoms that will be on the outside, while the major chunk will be more on the interior. Whereas if you try to make a sphere with around 80 atoms or so, then maybe most of them will be on the surface, that is outside of the sphere. So we will have a lot of atom on the surface rather than inside, whereas the bulk will have the opposite arrangement. So when we have a lot of atoms on the outside, then we have a larger surface area and thus a larger chances of interaction or larger place for interaction. Now, generally accepted material properties are derived from the bulk. That is typically of an element such as copper, which has metallic conductivity, but then it would also change and will produce surface that will also change the property and will also produce surface plasmon in nano regime. So usually copper does not have a strong plasmon property, but when we go to nano regime, then copper also starts to exhibit a strong plasmon property, because of which you saw different colors in the initial example where we saw different gold particles. Okay, so now let's see the methods that are there for the synthesis of nanoparticle. So nanoparticle synthesis can be classified into two major heads. That is, one is the top-down synthesis and the other one is bottom-up approach. So we'll discuss them one by one. So in top-down approach, nanoparticles are synthesized or constructed by removing existing material from larger entities. That is, a large scale or a bulk material is reduced or broken down systematically into dimensions of nanoscale. Now, this can be done using various techniques, such as various physical techniques such as mechanical milling or wet or chemical dry etching, then sputtering or lithography or e-beam etching or laser ablation or electro explosion. So these are some of the physical methods. There are also some chemical methods that are used and that are classified under top-down approach, which includes chemical etching. So chemical etching is one of the example of chemical methods in top-down approach. Now, in bottom-up approach, nanoparticles are synthesized by constructing atom by atom. That is, we collect or consolidate and nurture individual atoms or molecules into a nanoparticles. So this is carried out by a sequence of chemical reactions controlled by a series of catalysts. Bottom-up approach can have two main methods. So one is chemical method and the other one is biological method. So examples of chemical method include template support synthesis or CVD, that is chemical vapor deposition, then atomic or molecular condensation, and so on. While biological methods include catalytic reduction of metal salts or metal precursors using plant extracts or microorganisms as a whole, or enzymes that are isolated from microorganisms. Now, physical methods are basically time and energy consuming, and it is synthesized at very high temperature and pressure. While chemical methods are a bit simple, inexpensive, it works at low temperature, but it uses toxic reducing and stabilizing agent, which sometimes makes the nanoparticle non-biocompatible or harmful. Now, biological and green method is very easy method. It's an efficient and eco-friendly method. It eliminates the use of toxic chemicals, consumes extremely less energy, and produces safer products and byproducts. Now, let's see a quick comparison between top-down and bottom-up approach. So, in top-down approach, the nanoparticles are produced by size reduction from a suitable starting agent, as we have seen earlier in the previous slide. Whereas in bottom-up technique, the nanoparticles are built from smaller entities, for example, by joining atoms, molecules, and smaller particles. In top-down technique, size reduction is achieved by various physical and chemical treatments. We use physical methods for breaking down the particles or etching out the particles. And we also use chemical etching methods in top-down technique. Whereas in bottom-up technique, nanostructured building blocks of nanoparticles are formed first and then assembled to produce the final nanoproduct. Then in top-down technique, top-down production method introduces imperfection in surface structures of the product. And this is the major limitation because surface chemistry and the other physical properties of the nanoparticles are highly dependent on surface structure. So when you try to produce nanoparticles using top-down techniques, what happens sometimes is there are flaws that are caused due to etching or physical methods. Say, for example, if you're cutting down a bulk material and you did a overcutting or you did a undercutting, then there will be a change in the particle that you have produced, and that change will govern the properties of that particle. So in the end, it will alter the property of the nanoparticle, and hence you will not be able to get most of the nanoparticle same. So they will not be reproducible. Now, in bottom-up synthesis, as it mostly relies on chemical and biological method of production and hence produce reproducible products which have a similar properties and multiple production of that property will that particle will always have similar properties and similar tendencies. So it can be used for bulk manufacturing and bulk-based methods. Now, so this is basically a schematic to quickly show how it is made. So this is the top-down process. You have a bulk material, the bulk precursor material, and you break down the bulk precursor material into small fragments, and you then further break it down to nanoscale structures. Whereas in bottom-up approach, you have atoms, and these atoms are produced by reducing the metal precursors into pure atoms, and then these atoms combine to form clusters, and then these clusters combine to form nanoscale products or nanoparticles. Now, green synthesis of nanoparticles. As discussed, green synthesis basically involves enzymatic reduction of metal precursors or metal salt into atom of pure metal that comes together or aggregates together to form nanoparticles. Microorganisms like bacteria, fungi, then algae, as well as microbial enzymes are directly used for these reductions, whereas from plant source, plant extracts that are made from leaf or root, flower, fruits, or the peel of flower like banana peel, starch, or honey also act as reducing agents for the production of nanoparticles. Now, microbial synthesis is, of course, a readily scalable method. It is also environmentally good and compatible with the use of product for medical applications. But production of microorganisms is often itself is more expensive than the production of plant extract. So basically, when there is a choice between what reducing agent a person will choose for bulk production of nanoparticles, then often people go with plant extract, because plant extract are cheaper compared to microorganisms when you have to produce, because microorganisms you have to produce as well as you have to culture them and maintain them. Whereas plant extract, you can readily produce. Plant materials are cheaply available everywhere. So that's why for bulk production of nanoparticles, always plant-based nanoparticle synthesis is preferred. Now, plant-based synthesis of nanoparticle. Now, plants are basically the gift of nature. They are the resource of our country, and they exhibit a lot of medicinal values that we have seen through ages from our ancient literature like Rig Veda or Ayurveda and all those things. So that's why these plant extracts, they have a lot of medicinal properties. Now, World Health Organization has also accepted these drugs that are made from plant sources up to 80%, and they are used worldwide in all the developing countries. Now, India is a rich source of medicinal plant. We get medicinal plant all the way from up north, that is Himalayas, to Western Ghat to down south. So medicinal plant are very important in traditional medicine, as they possess various properties like antimicrobial property or anti-protozoa, anti-cancerous property, anti-fungal properties. So now when we use these plant extract, medicinal plant extracts to produce nanoparticles, they tend to get coated on the resulting nanoparticles. So basically they encapsulate the nanoparticles that are being produced. And this coating is called as capping. Capping of the nanoparticle. And this capping provides additional properties to these nanoparticles as well. What do I mean by additional properties? So basically, if a plant extract, say for example, it's a neem extract or a tulsi extract, which has an anti-cancerous and antifungal or antimicrobial property. So when it gets coated on a nanoparticle, say silver nanoparticle, gold nanoparticle, then the plant material is actually present there on the nanoparticle. And thus the property of that plant extract will be taken over by the nanoparticle, because the nanoparticle also has that plant material capped over it. So this is how the property of that nanoparticle will get enhanced, and that nanoparticle will become anti-cancerous or antibacterial or antifungal. Now, these capping agents or these capping layer that we get from plant extract, these also help the nanoparticle to get stabilized. Stabilized in the fashion that it stops all the unwanted reaction that nanoparticle can go through, because the nanoparticle at present is a pure metal molecule or pure metal collection of molecules. So it's a pure metal. So there is a high chance that it can get, it can react, it can get oxidized, for example. So these capping agents or these plant extract, when they cap these nanoparticles, they prevent the nanoparticles from getting oxidized as well. So, yeah, now we talk a little bit about phytonanotechnology. So phytonanotechnology is actually the synthesis of nanoparticle using fresh plants or plant extracts. Plants derived nanoparticle produced by readily available plant materials. The non-toxic nature of plant are suitable for fulfilling the high demand for nanoparticles with applications in the biomedical field as well as environmental field. And now these days the application are getting enhanced into agricultural fields as well. Now, recently successfully synthesized gold and silver nanoparticle using leaf and root extracts from medicinal plant, from medicinal herbal plant, that is Panax ginseng. So from there was a paper where they have produced gold and silver nanoparticle, and that gives excellent property of the material, the medicinal herbal plant properties onto the nanoparticle. Now, additionally, various plant parts, including leaves, fruits, stems, roots, and their extract have been used for the synthesis of nanoparticle. So it has been proposed that proteins, amino acids, organic acids, vitamins, as well as secondary metabolites, such as flavonoids, alkanoids, polyphenol, terpenoids, then heterocyclic compounds and polysaccharides. So basically what these are, flavonoids, alkanoids, they are basically phytocompounds which are present in the plant, and we use different kind of extraction procedures like water extracts or methanolic extracts and extracts like this to isolate different flavonoids, alkanoids, and other things. And we use those extracts for the production of nanoparticles using plant-based synthesis. Now, for instance, the hydroxyl functional group from polyphenol, and the carbonyl group from proteins of this Carolina ophiolensis extract could assist in forming and stabilizing of the nanoparticle. As well, what it also does is it provides additional functional groups on the nanoparticle, which are used for immobilizing or functionalizing the nanoparticle with different chemical or biological moieties that we want to modify onto the nanoparticle surface. So notably, dicot plants contain many secondary metabolites that are also suitable for the production of nanoparticle synthesis. This is basically the theory of phytonanotechnology. I mean, what are the phytocompounds or what are plant materials that can be used for production of nanoparticles, and what are the different types of nanoparticles that can be produced using these kind of nanoparticles. So basically you can produce gold or silver or copper or titanium. So there are a variety of nanoparticles that you can, metal nanoparticles that you can produce using phytocompounds. So these are all the examples that are there, which shows different plant material that are used for production of gold or silver or other nanoparticles, copper nanoparticles. So now with this, what we'll do is we'll see a few videos of production of gold and silver nanoparticles using plant materials. So I'll switch to that. Just give me a second. Yeah, so let's see what this guy has to say.
We have incorporated an eco-friendly method for synthesizing nanoparticles as an alternative to the chemical method. These methods utilize plants, and the plants we've chosen to use are cabbage, aloe vera, and garlic.
The process of synthesizing gold nanoparticles from garlic extract involves mainly the addition of chlorophoric acid.
The video is not visible.
The video is not visible.
Yes. I think you need to share again.
Okay.
Just stop sharing and share again.
Okay, just give me a second.
It'll work.
Stop sharing and then share again. so probably I have to start the video again. Now you can see the screen.
Yeah, right? Now it's visible, yes.
And the plants we've chosen to use is utilize the alternative to the chemical synthesizing nanoparticles as an alternative to the chemical method. These methods utilize plants, and the plants we've chosen to use are cabbage, aloe vera, and garlic.
The process of synthesizing gold nanoparticles from garlic extract involves mainly the addition of fluorochloric acid to a garlic extract solution. After the addition of sodium hydroxide to reach a pH of around 10, we boil the solution. We expect the solution to change to a faded pink, which indicates the presence of gold nanoparticles. Similar to the garlic synthesis, aloe vera extract is used to synthesize gold nanoparticles. However, these nanoparticles are triangular and their size depends on the amount of extract used. Greater the volume of the extract, the smaller the nanoparticles will be. Cabbage extract is used to synthesize silver nanoparticles, unlike the other plant extracts used. This is done through the addition of silver nitrate in a 9-to-1 ratio with the cabbage extract. A honey brown color indicates a successful synthesis of silver nanoparticles.
So
that was the production of gold and silver nanoparticle using
healthy leaves of Aurelia nervosa were collected from a herbal garden located in Hyderabad, Telangana, India. The collected leaves were dipped in distilled water to remove surface adherent dust particles and was shade dried for 15 days.
...126 grams of cut leaves were mixed with 2.5 liters of distilled water and then boiled for 1.5 hours at 60 degrees Celsius. It was then cooled to room temperature and filtered with muslin cloth to obtain clear leaf aqueous extract.
Prepared extract is used for silver nanoparticle synthesis. The reaction mixture was then shaken to ensure thorough mixing, and after 24 hours, the color was changed to dark reddish brown. The extracts were stored for further use. The next step involves the purification of the obtained silver nanoparticles. The silver nanoparticles which were obtained were purified and separated from the unreacted compounds by repeated centrifugation at 6000 RPM for 20 minutes twice, followed by washing three times with deionized water. The purified powder was obtained by a rotor evaporator, and the dried silver nanoparticles were then used for further characterization. Next step is the characterization of the synthesized silver.
So basically here what they have done is they have produced silver nanoparticle using leaf extract. So what they did was initially they cleaned the leaf and they dried the leaf. Once the leaf were dried, they made extract out of it. So here they have made an aqueous extract where they use water for it. We can also make ethanolic extract or for example non-aqueous extract with polar solvents. So depending upon the compound that is present in that plant that we want to coat on the nanoparticle, say for example if I have a tulsi leaf, and in tulsi leaf I know that there is a compound called compound X that is present when we make a aqueous extract out of it, and then there is another compound that is compound Y that is isolated when we make an ethanolic extract of it. So what we'll do is we'll first make aqueous extract of one set of leaf, and for the other set of leaf we'll do a ethanolic extract, and then we'll get that extract solution and we'll use that same extract solution to reduce a specific kind of metal precursor. So in case if you want to make gold nanoparticle, then you will use aurum chloride or aurochloric acid. If you want to make silver nanoparticle, then you will use silver nitride as metal precursor, and you will use this extract, the aqueous extract or the ethanolic extract, to coat the compound that is present in this aqueous extract or ethanolic extract onto your nanoparticle that will be produced. So you will reduce it, and now the nanoparticle that will be produced will exhibit the property of your compound X, whereas the other set of nanoparticle will exhibit the properties of your compound Y. And why is that so? Because that compound that was present in the water extract or the ethanolic extract, that is the compound X or compound Y has encapsulated or capped the nanoparticle, and thus the nanoparticle will have some part of that extract and it will exhibit the property of that particular compound. Now, once the nanoparticles are being produced, there are various methods of characterization that you can do. And now, since we have some time left, so I will quickly show the characterization as well.
Nanoparticles. Some analysis is used to determine the surface morphology and size distribution of the silver nanoparticles. Using UV spectrometry, the spectrum of the sample was seen to be in the range of 250 nanometers to 550 nanometers. The maximum wavelength was found to be at 490 nanometers.
So basically, you will do a UV whiz, and you with UV whiz, you will get a peak, and with that peak, you will be able to determine that the nanoparticles that are produced in your sample are of same dimensions and same shape. Because if they are not of the same dimension or same shape, then you will get multiple peaks. Whereas in this graph that you see here, you see only one peak at 490, the maximum peak. Whereas you see a shoulder somewhere around 400 as well. So that shoulder shows that there is the reaction is not complete. So when there is a complete reduction of the metal precursor, you will get one final single product, and that will be represented by a single peak. So that is the characterization of UV waves. Whereas in the previous slide, she showed a SEM analysis. So basically with SEM, you can also try to measure or try to see the particles that are produced. But the best method for checking the size of the nanoparticle, if you want to see, or how much nanoparticle are produced, or what is the exact shape of the nanoparticle that are produced, you use TEM. So TEM based analysis, when you do, you get the exact size, exact shape, and what are the different ranges of particle that are getting produced in your experiment. So that is all the information that you will get using a TEM based analysis. Now let's see further what they have to say.
This is due to the super plasma resonance effect. This effect is exhibited only by silver nanoparticles.
So yeah, so basically that's it. They are the two characterization method that she showed. She didn't talk about SEM, so SEM is another one. Okay, so yeah, that is more or less what I wanted to talk about nanoparticle and green synthesis. So if you have any questions, then you can go ahead. I hope anyone is listening, right?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, what is plasmon resonance?
So plasmon resonance is basically an optical property of a metal. So what happens is, to give an easy example, what happens is when you shine a light on a metal particle, what happens is it absorbs that light. And from that light, it gets an energy. Now, after absorbing that light, it radiates it back. So when it radiates back the light, that is the plasmon. And basically, due to that, you see a color. There is also a very strong technique, a strong biosensing technique that has been made utilizing this property of metals, the plasmon property. It is called surface plasmon resonance. So what happens there is a gold layer. And at the back of that gold layer, light is shined. So what happens is they arrange a glass piece or a glass prism in front of that gold layer in such a way that it will cause total internal reflection of the light beam. But due to this encounter of incoming light beam at the back of gold film, there is a release of energy in the opposite direction that is called evanescent wave. And they utilize this evanescent wave for the detection of anything that is bound over the surface. So this is a very strong biosensing technique called surface plasmon resonance. So they have utilized this evanescent wave thing in constructing many instruments. Then this fiber optic thing that is also based on evanescent wave. And there are other methods as well, which are based on the same principle. Did I answer your question?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any question?
Sir, hello? Sir, my next question is, sir, जो नैनो पार्टिकल्स को हम सिंथेसाइज करते हैं तो सर उस जैसे बीकर या किसी भी फ्लास्क में तो सर उसके अराउंड एल्युमिनियम फॉइल की सर हम लेयर क्यों कर देते हैं उसके ऊपर?
एल्युमिनियम फॉइल से कवर क्यों कर देते हैं उसको? हाँ
सर, जो वीडियो में मैंने देखा था वो एल्युमिनियम फॉइल से वो कवर हो रहे थे.
वो प्लांट एक्सट्रैक्ट, द प्लांट एक्सट्रैक्ट दैट दे आर यूजिंग, दे कुड बी लाइट सेंसिटिव, दैट्स व्हाई दे कवर इट विद एल्युमिनियम फॉइल. इन प्रिंसिपल जो नॉर्मल सिंथेसिस होती है उसमें इट्स नॉट रियली रिक्वायर्ड टू कवर इट विद एल्युमिनियम फॉइल, बट द प्लांट मटेरियल दैट दे वर यूजिंग माइट बी लाइट सेंसिटिव और दे वर ट्राइंग टू शील्ड द एनर्जी फ्रॉम द टेम्परेचर फ्रॉम गेटिंग लॉस फ्रॉम द बीकर, दैट्स व्हाई दे वर कवरिंग इट विद एल्युमिनियम फॉइल. एज सच देयर इज नो स्पेसिफिक रीजन फॉर इट. Any more questions?
Yeah, I hope there are no more questions.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Saurabh, once again, thank you so much for your time and this session. We'll get back to you if students have any questions
sure,
regarding
sure.
this nanoparticle.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.